back again on beautiful Chicago Street in downtown Joliet for Paws on 66. It's Animal Rescue Day, and one of the organizers here is Peggy Grandall. And Peggy, let's hear about this year's event.
Well, we're pretty excited, Jan, about this year. We've got almost 40 dog rescues here. We've got multiple vendors that are selling pet supplies. We have different pet service groups. We have a new pantry for people that need a little bit of help in the Joliet area. We have Spay Illinois doing low-cost vaccinations. We're hoping that tons of dogs get homes today and people really learn about rescue, and the best place to get a dog is right here in rescue.
Absolutely, and as you can see behind us, we got cages full of wonderful dogs from all over the country here today, some from the flooding areas, some that have been just pushed out of their homes because their owners didn't want them anymore, and just abused. So come on down today, take a look, and if you didn't make it this year, you can come on down next year. Thanks. And once again, State's Attorney Jim Glasgow is down here supporting this event. As you all know, Jim is a very wonderful advocate that we all have here for all kinds of animals that are abused and don't have homes. So Jim, what do you think today?
Well, the turnout is even bigger than last year, which I didn't think was possible. And it was 11 o'clock and it just started and the street was full. That's amazing. Any time you have any kind of an event to show compassion and empathy for our treasured pets, this is what you get. So it's really exciting. The League of Extraordinary Canines, and I'm trying to get off the ground, we had a meeting about a month ago with all of the rescues and all the humane societies. And the purpose of that first meeting is when I seize animals in court, I have to have a place to put them. And right now, the last time we seized five pit bulls, not too long ago, and you know, we had to put all of the dogs at Joliet Animal Control on the taxpayer's dime in a cage. Well, that's not the right way to do it. So I'm going to try and organize all these different agencies that are already set up to take animals that need a place and then have the ability to adopt them out into a loving home. So we'll probably have to have some testimony before a judge so that they can qualify them. And once they do that, then we'll have an avenue that'll be set up to save taxpayers' money and have the dogs be treated much better.
What about some foster homes? Is that included in that?
Yes, obviously, if we can get people to come forward and do that. But through the rescues, they have foster home setups already where people will take the dog for 3, 4, 5 months until they can be adopted. Because whenever their shelters are full, that's what they have to do. And, you know, I just saw that Wags the Wishes did something really cool. They had some young children, probably third, fourth graders, come out and read to the dogs.
I
saw the picture, and the little dogs were, like, enthralled.
Because someone's talking
to them. Yes, somebody's talking to them. Yeah. And they said also it triggers better reading skills for the kids because they take the time to make sure that the dogs can understand them, I guess. But, you know,
they understand.
It's the human interaction with the animals. It's worth its weight in gold.
They know more than people think they do. They're not dumb animals. They're very, very smart.
Yes, absolutely.
And they all need loving homes.
Yes. And last, about a year ago, we adopted an animal from Hopeful Tales. It was at a Habitat for Humanity event.
Mm-hmm.
And my wife saw this little dog, and it's a Chihuahua terrier mix. And then she never put him down. So I figured we're taking him home.
I know. And once you pick him up, you're done.
And he's a little bit bigger than he was then. That's all I'm going to say. He enjoys the food.
Well, that's okay. We know he has a very good home, and you love him, and you might go home with another one today, huh?
Well, we have three right now, so I think we're maxed out. But, well, you know, I'm always looking to refer other people. Somebody just told me, wait a minute, it was you. You don't have a dog right now. I'm putting you on the spot on television.
Yeah, they're all in doggy heaven right now.
Yes, well, you know, that's the worst part. My Great Dane passed away in August of last year. He was a 150-pound dog. I mean, that's like losing a person, literally.
It's your family member for sure.
Yes,
they're with you through thick and thin.
A lot of crying that day.
No doubt. Oh, I know. I've been there many times.
We have his ashes and a special memorial in the family room, so...
Or ours are at the cemetery over there in Lockport, and they all have little headstones, and I know it's a little crazy, but we never had kids, so those are our kids out there.
Right. Well, you mentioned that the police canines. Tracy Caliendo, who's the dog handler in Plainfield, she set out to create a cemetery to honor the police canines.
And I saw that as well, yes.
And I think last time I talked to her, she raised like $30,000 or $40,000. But that's a great start to something that should be countywide. Every police canine should be buried in a, you know, municipal.
With all honors.
Yes, with all honors, but in a municipal-owned area,
yes,
that will be preserved so that citizens and children can come and see. And now with these crazy apps they have, they could put an app on the headstone or a thing where you could scan your phone and then get a little history of the dog. See a video of the dog.
Perfect, because they are heroes as well.
Oh, absolutely. I'm trying to remember. Bert Badisher was telling me that the dog that he has right now saved his life on at least three different occasions.
I'm sure he did. Yes.
And how do you put a price on that? Literally, I mean, if the police officer dies because the canine's not there, look at the cost to him, his family, to the municipality.
Yep.
They're enormous. So you can't even put a price on the value of these police canines.
No, they are our best friend. And Jim, we thank you for everything you're doing. And you know, both of us are very advocate,
yes,
toward all these poor little animals. And who knows, I might go home with one or two today. I don't know.
All right, I'm going to follow you around. You can go home.
All right. Thanks, Jim.
Take care.
I'm here with Ruth from Collie Rescue, Greater Illinois. And as you can see, she has all these beautiful lassies, if you will, because that's how they're usually identified.
Correct.
So Ruth, tell us a little bit about your organization and how you got into this.
I got into this because I had two Shelties that passed away. And we thought, well, let's see about adopting a dog. Mm-hmm. And we thought the next step up would be Collies. So we found the rescue and put in an application. And it wasn't too much longer later that we were called and said, we have a dog for you. And then, well, we have another dog for you.
That's how it usually happens.
And then we were fostering, so then we kept another dog. Yeah, so yeah, right now, yeah.
It
yeah,
just blossomed from there.
It sure did.
So and who do we have, this beautiful black and white one now?
This is my girl, Bonnie. She is 16. And this is Rufus, who's 3. Fletcher is 8. And Lad is 10.
Now they're all
yours?
They're
all ours, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So how many are here to adopt today?
To adopt, we don't have any to adopt, but we bring our own personal dogs.
Okay.
But we have information, and we know we can look up on the website at collierescue.org to see what collies are available. So.
Okay, great.
And they're all in foster homes, so they don't go into a shelter. All the dogs, we have fosters who take care of them and teach them manners and stuff before they get adopted to their
wonderful
families.
So now, if people want to, you know, adopt a collie, who should they call, or who is there a website?
Yes, there's a website. It's collierescue.org, and you can see the application on there. You can fill out an application. If you see a specific dog online, or just put in your application and say, hey, this is what I'm looking for, and we'll find a dog for you.
Great. As you can see, they all want to be on TV because they came over here, and we've been influx with all these wonderful collies.
Right.
All right, Ruth, well, thank you so much for everything
you do.
Thanks for coming down here today.
Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, we really enjoy it down here.
Thank you. Well, as the state's attorney, Mr. Glasgow, was talking about earlier, about Wags to Wishes, where they had the kids come and read to the dogs, this is Terry, who is one of the owners of Wags to Wishes. So, Terry, how'd you come up with that idea?
Well, we have a lot of requests for the kids to come in and volunteer. It's not always safe, so we thought, what can we do? So we let them to come in, you know, read to the dogs, and then we bring them out, they interact, and they learn a lot about rescue.
I heard it was wonderful.
It was. They had a blast. We loved having them.
It was a great program, and I believe that because when we're talking, they really understand. They love that human contact, and someone's talking to them and reading to them. It's kind to them. They love it.
Teaching them kindness,
yep,
at a young age, they're going to replace us, you know. I can't do this forever, so.
Absolutely. So who do you have here?
So this is Chaos. He is a six-month-old Tibetan Mastiff.
Look at that face.
He's adorable, but he was purchased from a breeder, and he has a lot of medical issues. We are about $6,000 into trying to help him. They think he is a pituitary dwarf.
All right, so let's talk about these breeders that keep breeding and breeding and breeding,
yes,
and what happens to these poor little things. I know people want to go to the pet store, and they want to buy a dog because they think it's so cute, but they really don't know the whole entire background from,
right,
where they've come from. So explain a little bit about that.
You know, they're making money on these dogs, but when they're sick, they're handing them off to somebody else, and this dog was sold with these health issues. He could not keep food or water down.
Oh.
And he was just skin and bones when we got him. Luckily, the Puppy Mill Project is helping us with Chaos and his medical. But, you know, rescues step in and they help these dogs. We cannot line the pockets of the puppy mills and these breeders.
I know, I adopted a dog that it was with another family, and that poor little thing had nothing but problems, dry eye, crooked teeth, terrible skin, and it was the sweetest little thing, and I get it, and I wish that there's something more we can do.
It's sad to watch them go through it. Chaos is a full-time job right now for me. I mean, I have to hold him when he eats, hold him when he drinks. He is going to University of Champaign for treatment. And we're headed there Wednesday to find out more about his medical. But we're going to do everything we can for him because he didn't ask for this.
No.
And I do believe that the breeder should have stepped up and helped out a lot more and definitely not sold the dog. But we're going to do whatever we can. He's got a lot of support, so.
Well, that's wonderful. He seems so calm, the poor little baby. And so sweet, so sweet. Well, Terry, thank you for everything
thank
that you,
you
do with Wags to Wishes. And give us your website and a phone number if people want to get touch with you.
Sure. It's www.w2rescue.com and our number is 815-254-3110.
Okay. Well, thank you, Terry, so much. And good luck with Chaos. Well, everybody seems to be down here today, and now this is Mallory with the Will County Humane Society, and she's going to tell us a little bit about what the Humane Society does, because everybody has a wrong impression sometimes. So could you please explain that?
Yep. Our Humane Society has actually been around for about 50 years. It's Will County's oldest no-kill shelter in the area. So we rescue both locally and down south. We pull animals out of kill facilities and things like that, really bad situations. We'll bring them in, we'll rehabilitate them, and then we'll adopt them out to the local community. Average, it's about 400 animals every year that we'll adopt out, which is awesome, both from cats, dogs, and miscellaneous things such as, you know, rabbits and birds and guinea pigs, all that fun stuff. So yeah, we do a really good job, very good turnover for such a small location.
Well, the fact when you said no kill, people get the wrong impression.
Yeah.
They think the Humane Society, they keep them and then they put them down, but they don't. They do find homes.
Yeah.
Now, have you received any of the animals from the flooding areas down south?
We have worked with some groups, not directly from there, but from the ones like Tennessee, Kentucky. So if there's flooding down in like the southern states, they'll come up a little bit, and then we pull them from those facilities there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now do you only get the facility dogs, or do you get dogs that were lost? They might
we
be microchipped?
Well, yep, we get strays, we'll get owner surrenders, and we also get, you know, dogs from those facilities as well.
Okay, mm-hmm. Well, great, Mallory. Thank you so much. Tell your the hours of operation.
Sure, so like we have public viewing hours on Tuesdays, Thursdays, Saturdays, and Sundays, always from 12 to 5, so you're welcome to come in during any of those time frames to view the animals that we have.
Okay, and tell us about the adoption process through the Humane Society.
Sure. Our adoption process is not a same-day adoption process. So it is. It does take about 3 to 5 business days to get approved for an animal. We'll do background checks and various things like that in order to make sure the family's home is the best fit for the animal they're applying for.
Love it, love it, love it. You're not. They're just not going anywhere dog fights or anything like that.
No, absolutely not.
Because that was back in the day. That's what used to happen.
And there are plenty of people that still try. But our process is very, very important to keep them in the right place.
Wonderful. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you again, Mallory, and enjoy the day. Everybody seems to be down here, so we're going to try to get to talk to everybody.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, right now I'm here with Karen, and she caught my eye because she's walking around with these two little tiny chihuahuas in a little pink furry blanket, and I just had to ask her about them, and so she's going to be willing to share her story.
Hi, I'm Karen. I love chihuahuas. I just lost a chihuahua in January. She had Addison's disease, and I've been on the hunt to replace her. You can't replace a dog, but these two have come pretty close to it. I found these on Hope. It's h.o.p.e.
Okay.
I found them in Yorkville, and they had them up for adoption, and I went out and got them. I couldn't help myself, so I got both of them. The little black one, he has a heart condition.
Oh.
But now the Anti-Cruelty Society and Humane Society is going to they waived his adoption fee, and they're also going to take care of his heart condition also.
Ah, wow.
And so it's like, so I had to do it.
Absolutely.
I had to do it.
Absolutely, Mama. Congratulations.
Exactly. Thank you. And then this one, she is a blue chihuahua, and she's very rare.
Oh.
And it's like, when I saw her, the color, and I couldn't leave her alone either.
Now, what are their names?
The black one is Bo, okay. And the blue one is Dusty.
Dusky and
Dusty.
Dusty and
mm-hmm.
Bo.
Yep.
Okay. Well, they're just the cutest little things, and so, you know, when people want to adopt and they're afraid to take an animal that has a condition or something, just beware that if you'll take that into your home and give it a little extra care, that the humane societies and all these adoption agencies are willing to help with the medical expenses. So keep that in mind, because these are the forgotten little guys and nobody wants them. And, you know, everybody needs a loving home. Well, thank you for sharing your story, and we appreciate it, and congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you.
Well, if you're wondering and hesitant about getting a dog because it might be left alone, or you want to go on vacation or something, or it hasn't been trained, I'm here with Diana from Bright Dog Daycare Boarding and Training. And as you can see, there's all kinds of dogs, and they were voted best of Will County Pet Services in 2018. So, Diana, tell us a little bit about this.
So, we've been in operation for 3.5 years. We're family-owned and operated. Bright Dogs offers all-day daycare. So, if you're worried about leaving pets home alone for the day, there's a great place for them to come and hang out with other dogs. Boarding, we offer our boarding services. Within that, we also allow the dogs to go through daycare for the whole day. So, they're well tuckered out when they go to bed. We have large kennels, and all of our family is involved in the services.
Wonderful. Doggy daycare. Who would have thought back in the day that this would be a thing? But I love it because, you know, when you're working and you're working long hours and you just can't get home to let them out, it's good to know that they're well cared for, like if you were ahead of a child.
And so that's, we joke, our motto is yours like ours. We treat your dog just like they were our own. Our three dogs actually are, unfortunately, old, and they don't want to necessarily come to daycare on a daily basis, but we have senior dogs who come in. They have access to outside all day every day, so they can play outside. They get to go out in the weather, they get to hang out, but it's a blast, and the nice thing is that the dogs become our family as well. There's quite a few of our clients wandering around today, so they've all come up to say hi to us. It's been a pleasure.
Oh, well, thank you, Diana. Now, I know we're going to move right over here to the pet pantry because I see Bright Dog's Pet Pantry. So we're just going to move right over here.
Bright Dog's Pet Pantry, we realize that some people are literally a paycheck away from not being able to support their animals. The worst thing in our minds is having to give up a dog due to financial situation. So what we've done is we've partnered with Micro Pantries of Illinois. We have a micro pantry out front, and you can come and take what you need. You can leave what you have. It would be amazing if people stop by. We also have overflow within our building, so we are able to supply dog beds, blankets, sheets, towels, collars, leashes, and we have quite an extensive for cats and dogs.
Oh, cats as well.
Cats as well. So it's out in front of our location at 3105 Theodore Street in Joliet. There's a micro pantry out there. It is freshly stocked. There's a lot of stuff out there, including some toys people put in. So people can come and drop off their donations. If it fits in the pantry, that's great. If not, you can bring it inside Bright Dogs. We will store it. We'll have volunteer opportunities for kids in the neighborhood to come in and pack for the micro pantry. But don't let food or supplies be the reason you ever have to give up your dog.
Now, when you take donations, does that include blankets and towels as well?
Blankets, towels, dog beds, collars, leashes. So if for whatever reason you have extra supplies lying around, we will take them. We'll hand them out accordingly. Our goal is to be sure that if somebody adopts a new dog and then finds themselves in a situation, we can help them get some of their supplies to them.
Wonderful, wonderful. So the number would be the same as Bright Dogs Dog Parking. You're located in Theodore and Joliet, correct?
Theodore and Joliet.
Well, thank you. It's a very well-needed service, and we appreciate it.
We are excited to get it up and running.
And I didn't know that we had a micro pantry for dogs, but I love it because, like,
we are the first one in Illinois.
You're right.
The 50th micro pantry placed, and for the 50th micro pantry, it was the first pet pantry in Illinois.
Absolutely. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
And hopefully, you started something and it'll blossom all over, so people don't have to give up their pets.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So right now I'm with Amber from Fur Angels Animal Sanctuary, and she is the president and founder. So Amber, tell us what made you start something like this.
It's kind of a long story because I'm deaf. I grew up lonely and bullied. So growing up, animals were my best friend. They were always there for me. So I made a promise to them when I was a little girl that someday I'm going to repay them for everything they have done for me, being there for me as a lonely deaf child. And I knew I wanted to help animals, and we always have had animals. So when I got older, I realized that I could be involved in animal rescue. I started helping deaf animals. I found that there were deaf dogs, deaf cats, and a lot of time at that time, shelters usually put them down because of the myth that they're stupid, you can't train them, and nobody would adopt them. And they were being put down because they're deaf. And to me, as a deaf person, that was very offensive. So absolutely, I started getting involved with different rescues, helping them train how to work with deaf animals. And then one day, I got fed up. I said, that's enough. I'm starting my own rescue so I can help them. So we started helping deaf animals, and we grew to animals that are not deaf. And we grew helping cage pets, reptiles, and we even have some cage pets that are deaf too. So I'm just fulfilling my promise to animals that I made as a little girl.
You are amazing.
Thank you.
And
so
hearing
much.
Your story, I mean, I am so touched
so
by this lady. I mean, can you believe that she made a promise to the dogs and animals, and she fulfilled that promise, and starting her own business with cats and dogs and reptiles. She's just
bird,
everything.
Yeah.
So, where are you located?
We're located everywhere. We have found a home in Aurora, Oswego, Dummy, Chicago, Decatur, Joliet, Plainfield, and we have had some in Indiana. I'm from Indiana, and I moved to Illinois. Ugh. So we are everywhere.
Well, welcome.
Thank you.
Now, do you have a website?
Yeah, it's www.birdangelas.org.
Is there a phone number as well?
Yeah, but you're better off emailing the rescue from the website.
Okay, very good. Amber, you're an amazing woman.
Thank you very much.
And we need more people like you. And the animals cannot have a better friend. So thank you. I love you.
Thank you so much.
Well, believe it or not, I found a business called the Poop Brigade. I'm here with Rick and Matt, and they're going to tell you about their business and how they started it. Because some people, you know, they're hesitant to buy a dog. They want to clean up the mess. You don't have to worry about that anymore. So tell us about it.
Yeah. We started about 4 years ago. We offer a wide range of services on weekly, bi-weekly, monthly, whatever's best for you and your schedule. Everything's completely customized in your yard. So we show up, we make notes in our software, so we know exactly what areas to hit, what you need cleaned up, and we show up on a regular, reliable, consistent basis.
So how long have you been in business?
I think 5 years, correct?
Yep.
5 years? Yep. I just started, so.
Oh, okay, you just started. So what made you, what gave you the idea for this?
Yeah, you know what, I actually was reading about this service based in a completely different state, and they were talking about the success that they were having, and it was hard to believe. I wasn't really thinking that it would really take off, and I said, you know what, let's see what happens. Let's throw a truck out there and start picking up waste, and it's in real high demand. We're crazy busy. Every day we're completely swamped with a ton of clients needing the service. Because you know, you said it right at this beginning of the statement of you got a lot of people that have a lot of dogs that don't want to clean up after them. It's not fun. It's not why we have pets. We have it because they're enjoyable and they're good companions, and that's why we started.
Well, in our house, we call it landmine duty. So, do you have a website?
Yeah, at poopbrigade.com. You can log in. They actually have access to your own client hub when you have an email. So you can actually track your own invoices, track visits, request different services right through that hub online.
Perfect. So if you want to clean up after your animals, these are the super duper pooper scooper people to help you. Did I get that right?
You got it.
So if you want to adopt or get a dog and you don't want to clean up after them, the Poop Brigade are your folks.
Yep. Perfect.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Well, if you are interested in a particular breed, for example, a Cocker Spaniel, this is Cocker Rock Style Rescue.
Rockstar Cocker Rescue.
Got it all backwards, sorry.
That's all right.
Tell us your name.
My name's Lynn Turnquist. I'm the founder of Rockstar Cocker.
I got that all wrong, didn't I? And who does this?
I'm Reagan.
Thing.
This is Reagan. He just came in to rescue this morning.
Oh.
So he's a little unsure.
Oh my good. What's his story?
He's an owner surrender. The family just had situation come up where they just couldn't give him everything he needed. And we take them in. We send them to foster homes like Paige.
Just turn him around so people can see his face.
Look at those eyes.
And how old is he?
3 years old.
Oh, only three. Mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness. So scared.
He's going to be
He's
a good boy.
He's just shaking. He's so, look at that face. He's I so know. Sweet. So sweet.
But he'll relax and loosen up, and we'll see his personality, and he'll be a great dog.
So how many do you have currently? Just him right now?
Here today, we just have Reagan. Uh-huh. We weren't sure with the weather exactly That's what right, to expect. Right. We're here today, you know, spreading the word.
Absolutely.
Having our Cocker enthusiasts stop by and say hi. A lot of them follow us on Facebook as well as our website, and we cover the whole upper Midwest, so we have a lot of area to cover.
Yes.
Well, it's Rockstar Cocker Rescue.
Yes, because you're Rockstar.
Is it .com?
Yes.
.com. Okay, is there a phone number or anything?
No, but it's all on the website if okay. they need to contact
all
us.
All right. Well, Reagan, you sure are a beautiful boy.
Isn't he a good boy?
And oh, my goodness, he's so sweet. Oh, my goodness.
He will make a good pet. He will be such a good companion, won't you, buddy?
Such a sweetheart.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you so much for everything that you do, and thank you for coming down here and supporting Paws on 66.
Yes. Thank you.
Well, here I am with Samantha and her owner, John. And Samantha was rescued in a roundabout way, so I'm going to let John tell you how he got her.
Sure. I had a friend who rescued her in Missouri, and he had her for a couple years, trained her, and had an unfortunate situation where he could not take her anymore. So I took her in, and I've had her about 4 years, and she's been a great, great dog. So, yeah, everything about her is great.
And how old is Samantha?
She's eight years old.
8 years old. And all these people around here, she's very excited to see all these dogs.
She is very excited, yes.
She's pretty calm,
She's
huh?
very calm, yeah, but she sees all the dogs. And
all right, well, I'll let her dad take care of her. But and so you're an owner of a bar down here in Joliet, right?
I am. It's Johnny's on Hickory Street, 1008 North Hickory Street. The old Ted and Sophie's, so it's a new neighborhood sports bar, so.
Great.
So, yeah.
Okay, well, thank you for rescuing Samantha, and does she go to work with you?
No, she doesn't go to work, but sometimes.
All right, John, well, thank you so
much.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Bye, Samantha. She's busy meeting people. Well, here I am with Jackie, and she offers some very, very interesting services for pets.
We are Canine Physical Rehab and Sea Spot Swim.
And you have acupuncture?
Oh, we have acupuncture and chiropractic care.
And so that would be for an older dog or someone that have arthritis and other physical problems?
Yes. We also see puppies that have had issues. For the swimming, we do dogs that are overweight, need to leave energy, trying to think of.
How about rehab, when you have to rehab a dog? For
rehab, a lot of times it is for arthritis, older dogs, surgical procedures, dogs that have had injuries that don't want to do surgery, we will help to strengthen their limbs so that surgery is not needed. If that's the case, sometimes it still needs surgery depending on how bad the injury is.
Is it very expensive?
Some people think it's expensive. Where we're located, it's not as expensive as Chicago area.
Okay.
But our initial evaluations are $190, and it's 2 hours, and we do treatment the same day. And then we do recommend follow-up cares for physical rehab, usually about an hour a piece, and those are $85 for the hour. We also offer package rates at a discount. Swimming is $30 for a 15-minute swim, and we offer a discount if you prepay for a package of that as well.
And do you have a website?
Our website is caninephysicalrehab@yahoo.com is our email, sorry. Website caninephysicalrehab.com.
Okay. Is there a phone number?
Phone number is 630-264-9840.
Okay, and so I can kind of attest this a little bit. I mean, unfortunately, she wasn't in business, but years ago we had a little Maltese animal, little dog, sweet little thing, and she was we found her, and she had been interbred many times. But anyway, to make a long story short, she had severe arthritis in her hips. And depending on how much you love your dog, you don't want to see them suffer. We took her for acupuncture, believe it or not, and it did help her. And after she would have those treatments, she would just be running around like she used to, and they lasted for quite some time. So, you know, if you love your animal, and with us, you know, we'll do anything to keep them alive and to keep them comfortable until it's time that we'll let you know when it's time for them to go see heaven. It's well worth it. So if you're thinking about it, or if you have an animal that needs some type of rehab from a broken leg, it just hasn't been right, give these people a call and see what they can do for you. And all you can do is try it. So thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
All right, right now I'm with Angela from Forget Me Not Animal Rescue, and she has a very telling story to tell here about these little dogs right here. And get your handkerchief out.
All right, so we rescued these guys. There were 10 of them, 10 puppies and mom. They were abandoned in a building for 3 days, and then finally the owner came back and surrendered them all to the shelter. They were pretty in bad condition. They had a skin infection that took weeks to heal, worms, everything. So, and these guys are pretty shy, but they love dogs, and we've been boosting their confidence being around other dogs and people. So there's still, 4 of them got adopted, but there's still 6 puppies left that are all still looking for a home.
You know, and I noticed on this little girl here,
you
can see right here, I don't know if you can get into that, but that's just one of the sores that was found for these people that were breeding probably illegally.
Yeah, he said he was like, oh, I've never bred before, but I wanted to, you know.
Yeah, and then just forgot about him and left him. How horrible is that? But she's such a sweet little thing. What's her name?
This is Orchid.
Orchid,
and her
yes.
Blossom and Dolly.
And Blossom and Dolly are over here. And if you can get a shot of that ward, that would be great. And then they have other animals as well in the back. What other kind of dogs?
So Brody's over here. He's like a Dane Pit mix. And then there's Shepherd Healer mixes and Lab mixes over here too. Kind of
all right. So Forget Me Not. And how can you forget this little baby, this beautiful little girl? But she's going to blossom like a real pretty orchid now that she's been rescued. And she's waiting for a good home. So
if
she looks.
They like swimming too.
And they like to swim. So if you're looking for a little dog, don't forget www.forgetmenotrescue.com and 815-935-9503. Well, thank you so very much, Angela, for all that you do. And Orchid, I'm sure you'll find a very happy home, baby. Yes.
Yeah, she's super sweet.
Uh-oh. He says, what about me?
Yeah, he's like, I'm jealous.
Who is this?
This is Brody.
Hi, Brody.
He came from the same shelter they did.
Okay, Brody waited very patiently, and then all of a sudden he's like, what about me? So if you're interested in any of these guys, again, Forget Me Not Animal Rescue. Thank you so much. Well, right now, I couldn't resist the kissing booth. There's been so many wonderful babies here today. And I'm here with Karen, and this is part of her rescue, so I'm going to let her talk about it.
Thanks, Jen. We're a local animal shelter now, located on Republic Avenue in Joliet. We're here attending the Paws on 66 Rescue Day. There's tons of rescues here, lots of pets for adoption, all sorts of stuff to do with the kids. We've got snow cones and nail trims. All these lovely ladies are here volunteering today to help us.
Now, how can they get a hold of you? I know you do grooming as well. You still do that?
We do.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So
part of it's a grooming salon. Part is the animal shelter.
So do you have a website for your rescue?
We do. It's www.positiveimpactpetrescue. Our email is pip.rescue@gmail.com. We're on Facebook. We're on Instagram. And what else can I tell you?
Well, how about a phone number?
How about Simone? Our phone number is 815-730-6811. And this is our little Simone. She's here today looking for a new forever home.
Now, what breed is she?
She, we believe, is a Yorkie Chihuahua mix.
Yorkie
and she's about 10 weeks old. She's been vetted and had her spay already and her microchip and her shots.
So well, you heard of politicians kissing babies. I'm kissing puppies today. She's mighty sweet.
She's a very sweet little dog.
Okay.
We have a lot of sweet ones here today.
Well, Karen, thank you so much. Simone. Oh,
Right on cue. All right, Karen, thank you so much.
Thank you for having
us. Thank you, Simone. Well, you've all been to the dog track maybe now and then when you went down to Florida. Well, these are greyhound racers. And this is what happens to the dogs when they're done racing. They just go out to pasture. So I'm going to let Linda here tell you a little bit about greyhound racers, how they came about, and what's going on with them.
Hi, we're with four greyhound racers. We're a foster-based adoption group. We have greyhounds ranging from puppies to even maybe 8 years old. They make great dogs. They're not hyper, they're quiet, they're clean, very low energy breed, perfect pets for even apartments.
Now, Linda, you told me that you're going to get some more dogs in today. Where are they coming from and why?
Well, right now the tracks in Florida are in the process of closing down. So all the greyhound groups are going to be flooded with greyhounds. And they'll all be needing homes.
Now, when you say they're good for apartments, I've been told that these greyhounds, even though they're big in size, don't let that fool you. They can make themselves small. They love to be on your lap. They love to sit on the couch. And they're just little lovers, to be honest. But I say little in tongue in cheek because you can see how big they are. But they will make themselves small to fit on your couch or your lap, right?
Yeah, they definitely will. We call them the 40-mile-an-hour couch potatoes. They can curl up into tiny little balls. They don't take up much space, and they love cuddling.
If you have a rabbit at home, I wouldn't advise taking them home with you because that was what they were chasing at the track. But now, how old do greyhounds live?
As a larger breed, on average, they live to be about 12 years old.
Well, that's still very good, very good. And now how old would you say that some of these are that are coming in from Florida and from, what was the average age? Were they done racing like at 3 and 4 before they started to close these places down?
3 or 4. Yeah, generally they are done racing by the time they're like about 3 years old. Occasionally they will go back to the farms and be brood mamas, and we occasionally get them after they're done being their mamas.
Well, thank you so very much. Now, are they easy to adopt out? Are people hesitant, or do they really like the dog animal?
I think we have a good source of adopting them out. I think a lot of people like the greyhounds. I mean, you know, there's a lot of people that will come back and adopt one or two more. I mean, how many do we know that have more than one greyhound? I have three. You have two.
We're like a cult.
Exactly.
But that's because they're so calm, and they're happy to be resting and not running around a track all the time.
Right.
So, do you have a website?
Yes, we do have a website.
Oh,
it's www.4greyhoundracers.org. Please check us out.
Okay, well, thank you so much for everything you all do, and beautiful dogs, and I know that they will find a very happy home.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, okay, we're going to talk now about microchipping and about spaying, and I'll let Brittany start off.
Yes, so Spay Illinois is out here today at Pet Rescue Day in Joliet, and we are offering special discounts on spay-neuter, and we're doing a low-cost vaccine clinic here today, including $10 microchip special, and we're offering these services because it's such an important thing for the pets in our community. Spay and neuter is important for your pet's health. It helps them live longer, healthier lives, and it's just a great prevention thing, and also helps our local shelters with overpopulation. So we definitely recommend spay and neuter for all cats and dogs. And then we're also doing microchips because this is another important thing for if your pet were to ever get lost. It's a small implant that registers your pet to your home and your phone number so that if they are ever lost, they make it home safely.
So tell us your name and tell us a little bit about the process with the microchipping.
Well, I'm Frank. I'm actually the transport driver outreach. The microchip, get the microchip. It's about the size of a grain of rice. Goes on the back of the shoulder blade. If they're ever lost, it is a universal tracking, so a vet, a shelter could scan it. It comes right back to you. It's well worth it. Because if your dog is ever lost and doesn't have a microchip, you call a shelter, say my dog's lost. Yeah, there's about 400 dogs in that shelter. It's a lot easier.
Now, I know some people are hesitant because they think it's going to hurt the dog. Do you know how they stick it in there?
It's just a little injection.
Like a needle?
A little needle. It's about the size of a grain of rice. It does not hurt. We just ask that you don't touch it so it can heal. But it's very quick.
Wonderful. And more people should do that, even though if they're house dogs, they keep them in the yard. You just never know. People like to steal animals sometimes, or they do get out if the gate's left open. And so it's very important to get them microchipped. And then to talk about the spaying as far as longer life. I know people don't want to get their dog spayed or hit because, oh, you know, that's cruel. Well, really it isn't because, you know, they can get cancer of the uterus in the female dogs. And the same thing with the male dogs. They can get cancer of their private parts. I'm not going to say that on TV, though. But you people know what I'm talking about. And it makes them calmer, and they do live longer because they're not so excited about wanting to get out and stray and see where their next chick is coming from, especially with those boy dogs.
Very accurate.
So you're SpayIllinois at .org, www.spayillinois.org. And now, do you give discounts, or how does this work with paying?
Yeah, so today here at the Pet Fest, we're actually giving away discounted coupons for spay and neuter, but we perform spay and neuter surgeries about 4 days a week at our Lyle Clinic facility, and it is always low cost. We have special programs for families in need of assistance, like folks receiving SSDI, link card, things like that, where we offer scale-based payment for spay and neuter. So we just really want to make it accessible for any pet owner to really make sure that their pets can live longer, healthier lives.
And of course, so you have anesthesia, and it's a licensed veterinarian.
Yes, absolutely. We are licensed veterinarians. We like to think of it as that we're spay and neuter specialists. It's something we perform lots of surgeries daily. So it's a totally comfortable place, and everyone on staff is completely obsessed with your pets when you visit. So they're receiving plenty of TLC in the recovery. So
some pets that go to the office and recover.
Yeah, with the... they sit in my lap.
But we do offer other things. We do about 20 different towns, our vaccine clinics too. So it's not just special events. We are in Joliet twice a month. We're in Braidwood. We're based out of Lyle. Come and see us. I mean,
yeah.
Okay, Spay, Illinois. Don't forget, if you love your animal, want to live longer,
come get them spayed and neutered.
Exactly. Thank you so much for everything you guys
do.
Thank
you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, well, right now I'm with Sherry Johnson and her three therapy dogs. She works at the Child Advocacy Center through Jim Glasgow's office. And I wanted to tell about these dogs and my favorite one, Jackson.
Jackson, exactly. This is Jackson. Jackson is a career-changed leader dog for the blind. That was his original plan, but he was too distracted by squirrels to safely guide a blind person. So he came back to me as I was his puppy raiser. And Jackson has been the first dog in the state of Illinois to work in a children's advocacy center. And he's 10 years old now and still going strong. And then we have Mally, who is another career-changed leader dog. And then we have Kiwi, who is a courthouse dog. She can sit in the witness box to comfort.
Kiwi's a black one, right?
Yes, yeah. Yes. She can comfort a young child if they have to testify in court. And then this is Chris Vukmer. Chris, I'll let you introduce.
Hi, Chris.
Hi, this is Angus.
Angus
is one of our state's attorney dogs. Angus primarily works with our problem-solving courts, helping people in our drug court, veterans court, mental health court programs. He helps the secondary handler that works with him, who does group counseling with the offenders that are participating in that program. In addition, he does the same thing with Kiwi, with coming to court and helping people who have been victims of crimes, comforting them when they're getting ready to testify or awaiting sentencing.
Wow. Well, you ladies do a fabulous job with these dogs. The dogs do a fabulous job with the kids and people that need help with their issues, post-traumatic stress and all of that. And as you can see, they're very calm and very loving. And I've known Jackson for years, and we have a little relationship going.
Yes, exactly.
Well, thank you guys for everything you guys do. And as you can see, they're taking a rest right now, and they all have their vests with their names on it. There's Mally and Jackson and Angus and Kiwi right here. All right, thank you so much.
Thank
we appreciate
you,
it because it's really needed.
Thank you.
Well, I noticed this very interesting sign here, Stop Puppy Mills. And I'm with Marcia LaRue, and she's gonna tell us a little bit about what she does for that.
we do education, and we try to inform people of what's going on everywhere. It's a national problem.
Okay, well, our city manager just distracted her because he was behind her, so obviously he knows her. Come here, Mr. Shanahan, for just a moment. All right, so you're out here today, and what do you think about these puppy mills?
Puppy mills are not for Joliet.
And how are we going to stop it?
Well, it's just like events like this, making people aware of the situation.
So, now that you're down here, have you picked any rescue dogs up today?
We're at capacity. We got one right over there.
All right. Well, thanks for coming. I had to get you on because you were making my interview, my lady, laugh. So, Marty Shanahan, city manager. All right, Ms. LaRue. So, what got you interviewed, or interested in this?
Well, what got me interested is I started, 4 years ago, transporting dogs that were going from one place to another, from a kill shelter to a rescue. And then from there, it just spiraled. It just started meeting more people and got to know more about what was going on.
Tell us the condition of these animals when you saw them.
Actually, I have gone to a couple of the Amish puppy mills, but they were only inviting us because they're trying to make it better for everybody. Who knows?
Okay, all right. And who do we have here?
Kathy Kowalski.
Hey, Kathy, tell us a little bit about this.
Well, I've been an animal advocate for a while, and as soon as you get into the large numbers, which we call factory farming, it's very difficult to maintain the care of those animals. So that's what we're trying to help people understand. When they go and buy a puppy from a pet store, it probably 99% chance that it came from a puppy mill where dogs live in a deplorable conditions.
Well, on television, they show these commercials at night where there's cages stacked on top and they're crowded conditions and they're filthy, and the one top one is, excrement going down. Is that true?
That is true, though some states have passed laws where they can't stack those cages anymore. But cages are 6 inches larger than the dog, and the dog may never get out of that cage until
it's just cruel and heartless.
Well, if you care about animals and dogs in particular.
So yes. What can people do? Because I see you have these shirts, Democrats, Republicans, and then dogs are checked off. And then over here it says, does your legislature's dog friendly? So what can people do to stop this?
We go and we lobby our legislators, and we, of course, write emails and call them. And we're trying to get the more humane laws passed.
More humane laws passed. So people should contact their legislatures, in Springfield and Washington?
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much. It says here, Google.
It says it all.
Puppy mills. And on the other side, it says, say no to puppy mills. So if you're interested in trying to help this out so we don't have so many animals that don't have homes that are kept in cages just because they're breeding and they just leave them there to forget. As you saw earlier in the film, we had some other dogs that were abused just from somebody breeding them and then just didn't care about them. This goes on all the time and people are just not aware. So think about it. If you want a dog, you can get very many purebred dogs. You can get it from a private or a rescue. Anywhere, but just think twice about before you go to someplace and just buy a dog outright. Do the research. Well, thank you, ladies. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, well, right now I'm here with Judge Shane Stead and his wife, Mary Beth, and she has a rescue up for adoption here today. So, Mary Beth, tell us a little bit about.
This is Harvey. He's a hound mix, and he's 6 months old, and he's very friendly. He's with the Will County Humane Society over in Shorewood. So we've got two adopted just today. Some people just adopted two of our dogs today.
Oh, wonderful. Now, Judge, you just told me, and I know what a loss it is. You lost your golden about a year ago.
Right.
And I, as well, have lost several dogs in the last few years, and I know how hard it is. But you said something to me that was very interesting.
Oh, yes.
We're not quite ready to pull the trigger again yet, but we love coming to events like this because we get our fix, you know, we get our release. So we see all these dogs.
I know, when you're ready, the right one will find you.
Right. Always.
Always. Right. And when they're ready, they're ready. And when you're ready, it all comes together.
Right.
Well, we appreciate what you do with your volunteering, and he's such, oh, Harvey, you're a sweetheart.
Yeah,
you are
the Weld County Humane Society. They're in Shorewood, and if you want to adopt, it's a very reasonable cost. Everything is included, and they always love donations, too.
Oh,
so,
okay. Well, thank you, Mary Beth. Thank you, Judge, for coming down and supporting
thank you,
the event.
Appreciate it.
We
thank
appreciate
you
it. Much. And Harvey, I hope you find a forever home. Oh, got my doggy kiss. Right on cue.
There you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
All right, we have one of our hardworking officers from Plainville, Illinois, Miss Police Officer Caliendo, and she's here with her canine, Cody. And she's going to tell you a little bit about what she does with these canines.
Canine Cody is a 7-year-old German Shepherd from the Netherlands. He came from Shallow Creek Kennels out in Sharpsville, Pennsylvania. He is a dual-purpose dog, so he is narcotics, handler protection, he tracks, he does articles. Just kind of an all-around patrol dog. So he's been with the department for 6 years. 2013 was of May was his starting rookie year, so kind of a veteran as we speak. I've been with Plainfield for 23 years, so we're both been there for a while. He'll be with us for a couple more years, hopefully, and we look forward to coming out here every year and doing our little demo. So we also have the Plainfield Police Canine Memorial back in Plainfield that we started 2-3 years ago. So feel free to log in on our Facebook, which is the Plainfield Riverfront Plainfield Police Canine Memorial.
Yeah, we were talking about that a little bit earlier, and that you started this because these animals that go with our partners with the police department and save their lives, they are truly need to be honored just like a person, because they are just as important, if not sometimes,
absolutely,
in crises. And you started that memorial, right?
Yes. We've had 8 canines in Plainfield, and after our last canine Aaron passed away from a medical emergency while on duty, it just, you know, it kind of took it to heart that these dogs get kind of forgotten, and we just want to remember them. We also remembered Canine Blaze, which is from the Plainfield Fire District. She just passed away this past year, so she's also going to be remembered at our canine memorial. So, you know, these guys bring us home. I have 2 kids I go home to, and you know, this dog will take a bullet for me, for anybody to, you know, to get me home safe to my children. And he's part of the family as well, but he's also my partner. So
now when he retires, will you get to keep him?
Yes, ma'am. I buy him for, we usually buy him for $1 from the village, and then he becomes our house pet. So right now he's a work dog, and that's pretty much how he lives his days. And then he'll be able to retire and live on the farm and play with all the animals that are out there.
Well, thank you so much for everything you do, and especially for bringing the memorial to fruition. And I hope that more police departments will do that around the nation. And Cody, I know you want to go home and play now, so you've been working all day. He
yes.
wants me to play
same
tug with him.
There you go. It's a good workout,
you.
At least.
All right. Well, thank you so much.
Well,
there
you.
We go.
There you go.
Okay, I'm here with Consetta with Paws Cross Rescue Resource. And what interested me in was, first of all, it's this sign here. It says, alone we can do so little, together we can do so much. Helen Keller. Well, if y'all know about Helen Keller, she was blind and deaf. And apparently, this is a Keller's cause. So I'm gonna let Consetta explain to you about it.
Hi, Keller's cause is prevention of double merles. And a double merle, if you don't know, is a result of breeding 2 merle dogs together. People do this because they think it's desirable. You'll get more merles. No, actually it causes defects. There's a 25% chance in each litter that you will have dogs with blindness and deafness issues, different size eyes, white, mostly white coats, different, totally different than an albino. But and I had someone actually say to me today, well, how is that possible? Merle dogs are sterile. Not true. Obviously, they can be bred together. A merle is a very desirable coloring in a dog. So by thinking you can breed 2 of them and get more, you actually produce a birth defect. And these dogs are very hard to adopt. They're handicapped, and this is totally preventable. It's just the result of poor breeding.
And again, explain the Merle dog.
Well, the Merle is a coloration dog. I don't know any of the pictures here. This is our ambassador, Stevie. This is Stevie. He's a result of a double Merle breeding. He actually is deaf. He's totally deaf. He has some eye issues, different color eyes. He's pretty sighted, though. But again, it's a result of bad breeding.
Okay, and that would be coming from puppy mills or just people that want a special dog?
I mean, a lot of people, of course, puppy mills will breed to get more of a Merle dog, more desirable. It's not limited to that, sadly. Even some backyard breeders, it could happen. They think it's desirable to get more Merle dogs. So.
All right, well, thank you so much. If people want to get involved, what should they do?
Contact Keller's Cause, and we are right here. kellerscause.com, and there's also www.doublemerlesinfo.com. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you for bringing this to our attention. I don't think any of the viewers have seen this before, a Merle dog. I know I didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
And so I thank you for being here today and for bringing this to everybody's attention.
Thank you for your interest.
Thank you. Well, right now I'm here with George and Delsina Hawkworth, and this is her dog, and he's been a rescue for she rescued him a couple years ago?
He's four, so 4 years ago from Hopeful Tales.
About 4 years ago from Hopeful Tales.
Mm-hmm.
And tell us about your rescue. How has he been for you?
Well, I trained him to be a service dog. He's been absolutely wonderful. He can't look at the camera because he's paying attention to what's going on behind us, but that's part of his job.
Well, that's amazing that you said he's a service dog, because a lot of people think rescues cannot be trained to be a service dog, that they have to be purebreds. And George is a perfect example here. And what exactly does George help with?
George does hearing alert and vision alert, and he does some retrieval things, and he also is just a general wonderful companion and watchdog, and sometimes hunter. We don't like that part too much, but we make sure that
George,
he has plenty of time to run around and get his energy out, because he's a herder. And we're here in front of Positive Impact.
Yes, we were here earlier.
And they had lots of wonderful dogs available for adoption.
Now,
not
George,
that we need another one, but we love the rescue community.
Well, yep. George, I hear you're a singer and you sing opera. Are you up for that today?
I don't want to get him
singing. No, because the piano's not here, right?
Right, and then he won't stop. Nobody wants to hear that. He's a little out of tune.
All right, well, thank you for bringing
yes,
him down
thank you
and
for
telling
having us
a little
thank
bit
you for
about
putting
how
this together.
He can be trained for a service dog, and looks like he wants a drink of water.
Yep, we're going to go do that next. Thanks so much,
all right,
Jane.
Thank you.
Day.
You too. Well, one more coordinator. This event wouldn't be possible without Morgan Mason. And as you can see behind us, how big this event has grown. So we started out this program with Peggy Grandall, and now Morgan's going to finish it off for us. So, Morgan, what do you think about today?
It's been such a fantastic day. The weather held out for us, and we just had so many rescues, over 70 rescues and vendors, and so many adoption applications being filled out. Lots of dogs getting vaccinated, pets getting microchipped, which is so important. So really, it's just been a fantastic day for everyone.
Absolutely, and there's families down here, and there's food vendors and other types of vendors for dogs, doggy masseuse even, acupuncture, chiropractic. I mean,
yes, everything you can imagine.
Everything, and some games for the kids to play. And of course, there's the kissing booth, which I had to go into.
Of course.
But the event is bigger than ever, and I think next year will be really taken off. And like you said, so many dogs are out here, and so many want these homes, and people are here, and they are adopting today, I'm telling
yes,
you.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. And that's the whole purpose of this event, Paws on 66 Pet Rescue Day.
Pet Rescue Day. Well, Morgan, I think we're going to close it out at that. Thank you for another successful event. And if you missed today's event, come on down next year. It's usually the second Sunday in June, and again, you can bring your families, kids are down here, and it's just a nice way to spend your Sunday afternoon and maybe go home with a furry baby.
Oh,